morning. It's good to see everybody. This is the day the Lord hath made. Let us rejoice and be glad in it. Whether you're visiting with us for the first time or a lifelong member, whether you're here in person or whether you're online, we're glad you're here. My name's Bob Payne. I'm your worship leader this morning. And together with Pastor Beth, if there's any questions anyone should have regarding our worship service, I'd be glad to help you answer it. At this time, let's prepare our hearts and minds for worship by listening to the prelude and the bringing in of the light. Please stand as you're able and join me for the call to worship and remain standing for our opening hymn. Followers of Christ, God calls us just as we are to live as truth tellers and gospel bringers in the world.
God, we know you call us, and still we ask, who am I that you would call me?
Like Moses standing before the burning bush, convinced of his unworthiness to lead your people out of bondage, we ask,
who am I that you would call me?
Like Peter, who thought he got it right, only to realize that who Jesus is doesn't meet his expectations of who a Savior should be, we ask,
who am I that you would call me?
As we raise this question to God today, we open our hearts to receive God's answer.
You are my beloved children. You are my disciples. You are my people called to share the love of God for the transformation of the world.
Will you love my name be known? Will you May be seated. Good morning and welcome here to Calvary United Methodist Church. I'm Pastor Beth. We welcome you here with us in worship. We also welcome those that are watching online. I'm not sure what has caused the uptick in our online viewership, but we now have 500 people that are subscribed to our YouTube channel. So those folks are actually receiving an email that the service has been uploaded. And so we want to welcome those folks into worship with us as well, and into ministry and mission. So lots of ways that you can be involved in the life of the church. We have an exciting month of activities this month. So being the 1st of September, 2nd of September, is it the 3rd of September now? Jeez. So the 3rd of September, the first Sunday of September, how about that? We are celebrating a new love offering this month for Escape Ministries, and this is a nonprofit organization that's based out of Sykesville, Eldersburg area, serving community members and families in need. And we're actually going to be doing an active part of ministry with our love offering this month. So you can do one of two things, or three things. You can use those love offering envelopes that are in front of you or our online giving portal to give to Escape Ministries. 100% of our love offering will go to support that ministry down there in Eldersburg. You can donate some items for our bag lunch program, which we're going to be packing in a couple of weeks. It's a Tuesday night. What's the date again, Renee? The 19th in the evening at 7 p.m. we're going to be here. It also happens to be blood drive night. So if you happen to be giving blood at the tail end of the blood drive, just stay and help us pack a few bagged lunches for the folks down at Escape Ministries. And the third way is come in and help out with us that evening. So we're looking forward to continuing this mission and this outreach. So the entire month of September, you can give generously to the Escape Ministries and also take part in that. We also want to celebrate music is kicking off again. So with the start of school, Miss Ella is kicking off her Thursday night music classes. So we have a class at 7 for kids. And so we encourage kids of all ages to come. And it is a fun time of exploration of music. So they're learning how to play instruments. They do a little bit of singing. We will be working with them to do something for Christmas and Easter. And so it's just a fun way to spend some time in music and learning and being in a faith community as well in the midst of all that. So Miss Ella will have that from 7 to 7:30. And then at 7:30, we're inviting adults and youth age folks that like to sing. You don't have to be able to sing. You just have to like to sing. To come and join in the choir time. So we would like to have a little bit more music incorporated into our worship time, and I'd love, love, love to see some new singers. So if you are interested in any of that, that is this Thursday evening at 7 and 7:30. Next week is going to be a busy day in the life of the church on Sunday morning. We are back for Sunday school. So Sunday school for all ages. Our Sunday Seekers group will be meeting in the library here. And then our kids are going to be in all different areas of our education wing. We need you to register online for those classes, specifically the young people, because we need to know how we're going to distribute those classes in the age groups, make sure we have an equal pairing of teachers and students in those classes. So if you're going to be joining us, we just ask that you register online so we have accurate information of your students. Grade, birth date, and all the emergency information that we need. So the rest of those announcements, you can look in our bulletin, and also make sure you're getting the crier. If you're not receiving the crier on a weekly basis, I can help you get that signed up. And with that, I'm going to invite the kids to come up. And if you brought your backpack, great. If you didn't, I still have something for you to take home with you that you can add to your backpack. So this morning, we're doing two things. We're going to bless these backpacks and these kids that are heading off to school, but we're also blessing our teachers and anyone else who works in the school system. So I know, I mean, there's just tons of different aspects of ministry that happen in the life of the school. So you've got bus drivers, you have lunch people, you have custodians, you have staff, you have administration, all of the many aspects of school. And I know our teachers and our administrators are already back in school. So we appreciate you, and we have been praying for you, knowing that you are dealing with new things. And so what we're doing this morning, what we have here are a couple of tags. So you get to take a tag and put it on your backpack. That you can put your name and stuff. It says Amazing Grace, how sweet the sound. And then moms and dads, and even maybe you give these to your husband and he can put them in your lunchbox. It's like for up to 2 weeks of little prayer cards that you can put in the kids' lunchboxes. And you can write a little note on the back of them and just let you guys know that with you goes the love of your church and your pastor and all the aspects that we love you here. And so those are for you guys to take with you today. And even if you didn't bring your backpack, I'm still going to make sure you have a tag to take home, okay? So why don't you guys come around here? Let's put all these backpacks in the middle here, okay? Augie, you want to come over a little bit closer so you can join us over here? We're going to say a special blessing all over all of these things. And I just ask everybody to pray with me. Dear Lord, we want to begin this new school year as we begin each new day by acknowledging your presence among us with your blessing and guidance. Lord, watch over our students and teachers and staff and administrators and the owners of these backpacks as they take the next step in their education. Loving Shepherd, you call each one of these children and teachers to follow you. So help them to seek out your guidance both throughout the school year and each day of life by grace and faith in you. These backpacks will be filled with books, but fill their lives to overflowing with your countless daily blessings. When they become overwhelmed or stressed and anxiety, their spirits seem low. We pray that these students find comfort in your word and knowledge of your constant presence. When they encounter sadness or grief, whether at school or at home, we pray that these individuals will know that you provide the spirit of comfort to all who mourn. When they are faced with temptation to stray from your righteous path, remind them that you offer love and forgiveness for those who call upon your name. Keep their hearts and minds pure, their lives a reflection of your love for them. Bless them, we pray, to see your face in the faces of friends, teachers, parents, and others who gather with them this year. When they encounter persecution or bullying or hate or distrust, particularly when they are standing up for what is right and holy, make your presence known, so that each child, teacher, staff member is reminded of your promise to not leave us or desolate or alone. We gather here with these children and these folks in our community of faith, in your name, Jesus, welcoming you to the circle of love and togetherness that binds us as your friends. We pray that their faith in your saving power and promises is strengthened, and that their behavior and faith shines as an example to others of what it means to be children in your family. With confident hope in God's watchful care, I bless these backpacks and their owners, the teachers and staff and administration, in the name of the Father and the Son and the Holy Spirit. May all of us, young and old, be strong in faith and filled with the Spirit that we might be a blessing to all in your world. Almighty God, hear our prayer and accept our praise. In Jesus' name, amen. All right, so you guys each get a tag. Here goes Foggy. And a bag with your, here, make, take an extra one for your mom. She needs one of those. Take them, take them all. There you go. And then we have Children's Church. So here you go, Tanner, that's yours. All right, there's yours. All right, so we've got Children's Church. Mr. Brian's going to go down, and we're going to prepare ourselves for our offering and our offertory by Miss Anna.
Thank you.
be seated. Please join me in the unison prayer of confession. Loving God, you call us to turn away from our own selfish interests, to take up our cross and to follow after you, to find our lives by giving them up to your greater purpose. So we come before you this morning with open hearts and open hands, eager to hear your word and eager to know your will. Through the power of your Holy Spirit, move within us and among us as we worship. Open our eyes to your presence, open our ears to your call, open our hearts to one another, and then send us back out into the world to live and work as your faithful disciples.
Continue our prayers, and as we reflect on this holy ground, may we be reminded each and every day that the ground we stand on is all holy. Whether we find ourselves in a school full of children, in a grocery store full of people, on the corner of a street watching a parade go by, wherever it is, Lord, when we are here in your presence, we are standing on holy ground, consumed by the love that you share for each and every one of us. No matter the walk of life we come from, no matter the plans that you have set before us, we are reminded today in our confession that while we may be broken, and while we may be led astray, get off the path set before us, your love and forgiveness is unbound to any limitations. And so, Lord, we celebrate that today. The gift of your presence in our lives, not just here in worship, but as we leave this place and as we gather together in new places. For many of our children this week, that will be new schools and new classrooms, new teachers and new friends. But even for some of us, there are new things on the horizons. And for all those little anxieties and all those little things that make us afraid or unsure, we call out to you in prayer, Lord, to strengthen us, to give us all that we need, but especially to remind us of your presence this day and every day. But
but especially when the days get dark and the troubles seem so much. Give us your presence, your comfort, your healing, and your strength. As we are reminded of the blessings of your Son Jesus this morning, through the act of communion and this act of worship, we lift that prayer he taught us all to pray. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen.
Our first scripture reading this morning is from Exodus chapter 3, verses 1 through 15, about the burning bush. Now Moses was tending the flock of Jethro, his father-in-law, the priest of Midian, and he led the flock to the far side of the wilderness and came to Horeb, the mountain of God. There the angel of the Lord appeared to him in flames of fire from within a bush. Moses saw that though the bush was on fire, it did not burn up. So Moses thought, "I will go over and see this strange sight, why the bush does not burn up." When the Lord saw that he had gone over to look, God called to him from within the bush, "Moses, Moses." And Moses said, "Here I am." "Do not come any closer," God said. "Take off your sandals, for the place where you are standing is holy ground." Then he said, "I am the God of your father, the God of Abraham, the God of Isaac, and the God of Jacob." At this, Moses hid his face because he was afraid to look at God. The Lord said, "I have indeed seen the misery of my people in Egypt. I have heard them crying out because of their slave drivers, and I am concerned about their suffering. So I have come down to rescue them from the hand of the Egyptians and to bring them up out of that land into a good and spacious land, a land flowing with milk and honey, the home of the Canaanites, Hittites, Amorites, Perizzites, Hivites, and Jebusites. And now the cry of the Israelites has reached me, and I have seen the way the Egyptians are oppressing them. So now go, I am sending you to Pharaoh to bring my people, the Israelites, out of Egypt." But Moses said to God, "Who am I that I should go to Pharaoh and bring the Israelites out of Egypt?" And God said, "I will be with you, and this will be the sign to you that it is I who have sent you. When you have brought the people out of Egypt, you will worship God on this mountain." Moses said to God, "Suppose I go to the Israelites and say to them, 'The God of your fathers has sent me to you.' And they ask me, 'What is his name?' Then what shall I tell them?" God said to Moses, "I am who I am. This is what you are to say to the Israelites: 'I am has sent me to you.'" God also said to Moses, "Say to the Israelites, 'The Lord, the God of your fathers, the God of Abraham, the God of Isaac, and the God of Jacob has sent me to you.' This is my name forever, the name you shall call me from generation to generation." And from Matthew chapter 16, verses 21 through 28, Jesus predicts his death. "From that time on, Jesus began to explain to his disciples that he must go to Jerusalem and suffer many things at the hands of the elders, the chief priests, and the teachers of the law, and that he must be killed and on the third day be raised to life." Peter took him aside and began to rebuke him. "Never, Lord," he said, "this shall never happen to you." Jesus turned and said to Peter, "Get behind me, Satan. You are a stumbling block to me. You do not have in mind the concerns of God, but merely human concerns." Then Jesus said to his disciples, "Whoever wants to be my disciple must deny themselves and take up their cross and follow me. For whosoever wants to save their life will lose it. But whoever loses their life for me will find it. What good will it be for someone to gain the whole world yet forfeit their soul? Or what can anyone give in exchange for their soul? For the Son of Man is going to come in his Father's glory with his angels, and then he will reward each person according to what they have done. Truly I tell you, some who are standing here will not taste death before they see the Son of Man coming in his kingdom." The word of God for the people of God.
Will you pray with me? Lord God, for the words of my mouth and the meditation of all of our hearts, may they be acceptable to you. Amen. Some of you might not know, this week I took a new journey in teaching for the first time, not in a church setting, but on a university setting. So I've accepted a position at Stevenson University as an adjunct professor, and I'm teaching modern history, U.S. modern history, to mostly freshmen and mostly athletes in most of my classes. It's been an exciting week, but it didn't get off to such a good start. I had my first class on Tuesday, so I'm teaching a Tuesday, Thursday afternoon class and then one Thursday night class, which is the same class, just two different groups of students at different times. And so Tuesday afternoon, I went in, I had my my PowerPoint ready, I had all my lessons ready, I knew exactly what I was teaching. I actually had all of Thursday stuff ready too, because I had my Thursday night classes, both of those lessons together. So I was ready for the whole week and ready to go. And what happened? Nerves just completely took over. I'm all of a sudden not standing in front of a group of people that I know and that I love and that love me. I'm sitting in front of probably the most judgmental group of people I've ever seen in my life. Because they're looking at me going, "What is this lady doing here?" And I'm looking at them going, "Oh my gosh, these are brand new. They're freshmen. That entire class are all freshmen." So I'm looking at my kid, who's also starting her first year of college. I'm looking at her friends, and actually two of her friends were in the class with from Liberty High School. So that, you know, added to a little bit of the anxiety and the stress. But that's not really the point of my message this morning. The title of my message is Embracing Transformation by Journeying Through Self-Awareness and Faith. And the three points that I really wanted to focus on this morning was the painful awareness of self, the evolution of self-understanding, and then moving from shame to grace. And so when I was writing this week, it didn't have anything to do with what I was teaching, but it had everything to do with the experiences that I was having. So I'm trying my best right now to tie these two things in together, because you might wonder, why would Pastor Beth take on something else? Why do I need to, you know, find another job and something else to do? Well, a lot of you were with me when I went through my doctorate program, and that was enlivening for me. It juiced me. It gave me things to think about and things to talk about and things to work with and ministries that I could create with you guys. And when I finished that, and we had COVID too, so that was like a whole nother challenge. But when I finished that work, I felt dry. I felt, you know, bored. Not that you guys bore me, but like I needed something else to give me that spark, to give me something in my own life and in my own self-awareness of what I needed to do. And so that's why I've done this. That's why I've done it. It's not going to take me away from Calvary at all. In fact, I actually see ways in which we may be able to connect with one of our universities that's right in our backyard. John Yeh is an alumni from Stevenson, and they're really close. And these are young people. Like I heard one young lady in the front row the other night, we were talking about Labor Day, and she's like, "Oh, are you going home?"
And the other student said, yeah. And she said, I can't. I live in North Carolina. It's too far for just the day. So there's still a lot of students there that are international students and far away students that are there studying. So lots of ways I think that we could branch this out. But as I embarked on this journey and this message, I realized that we aren't just beginning classes and going back to school and starting new things, new assignments or lectures, but we're also stepping into deep waters of faith and self-discovery. And that's what happens when you do something new. Whatever it is, whether it's, you know, joining a new club or beginning a new exercise or, you know, shopping in a new store, you have an opportunity to do that self-discovery and self-awareness around that new experience. But it also gives you an opportunity to embark more deeply on your faith journey. So as we embarked into Exodus this morning and heard that story of Moses, last week we heard about him in a basket. Today he's standing in front of a burning bush. But we hear the story from the Exodus and then the Matthew gospel story, connecting them to the journey of faith and the importance of knowing God and that transformation that follows. You see, when we know who God is, when we know what God's name is, that transformation is already beginning. Our spiritual journey is akin to a quest for knowledge, is it not? Just as we prepare for a new school year with enthusiasm, we also approach our faith with the desire to know and to experience God. The story of Moses encountering the burning bush is a remarkable example of this pursuit. Moses, tending to his father-in-law's sheep, unexpectedly stumbles upon God's presence. And this encounter leads to a declaration of faith as God reveals his name, asserting his eternal nature and the promise of liberation. In Matthew, we find Jesus revealing to his disciples the path he must take, a journey marked with suffering and death and resurrection. And Peter's initial reaction showcases the challenge of aligning the human expectations with that divine purpose. Declaring our faith often involves confronting our preconceptions and yielding to God's greater plan. And that's where we have this painful self-awareness. A significant aspect of our journey of faith is recognizing our own limitations and imperfections. Miss Judy asked me an interesting question this morning. She said, how did you know you messed up? Or something along that. How did you know it went wrong Tuesday, my first class? Did somebody tell you this? Did somebody give you feedback? No. I looked at myself and I said, that wasn't my best work. I was nervous. I sped through two lessons in one day. I talked about things I shouldn't have talked about. I mentioned things that they didn't understand. I was all over the place. And I had that painful moment of self-awareness. And that is the same thing that happens in our faith journeys, is recognizing our own limitations and our imperfections. Because no time did God ever say we had to be perfect. Moses, despite being called to a divine mission, responds with self-doubt as well. Who am I? I said the same thing. Who am I standing up in here talking to these kids about Reconstruction, slavery, and civil rights? Who am I? Moses asks that same question, echoing the doubts that creep into our own hearts when we're in these new journeys. The encounter with God exposes our inadequacies, causing us to question whether we are truly worthy of the tasks laid out before us. And similarly, Peter's exclamation, "Get away from me, Lord," reflects his awareness of his own unworthiness from the presence of Jesus. These moments of acute self-awareness can be painful, but they are essential for growth. Just as a student might face challenges in subjects they're less familiar with, we encounter moments of vulnerability in our faith that push us to rely more fully on God. Our journey of faith mirrors our educational journey. We begin with foundational knowledge and gradually deepen our understanding. Our initial feelings of inadequacy and unworthiness are natural starting points, akin to a student grappling with new concepts. However, just as our understanding of complex subject matters matures with time, our understanding of ourselves and God evolves too. If you've ever taken a Bible study with me, I talk about that spectrum of the revelation that God gives us. And we start here at this little section here, that's what we know about God, but it just keeps growing as we grow in faith. And as our faith journey grows, that's what happens, to a point where we have this vast awareness of who God is. But it starts with the fundamentals. Confession becomes the starting point of our relationship with God. A humbling acknowledgement of our need for God's grace. But this confession shouldn't remain our final stance. As we draw nearer to God, we begin to grasp our worthiness, not because of our own merit, because due to God's transformative love. Our prayers shift from mere confessions to committed intercessions as we recognize the privilege and the responsibilities of being part of God's purpose. The journey from inadequacy to worthiness mirrors a trajectory from shame to grace. I went home that Tuesday afternoon, and my first word was recalibrate. I had to recalibrate from what I was doing. I talked to some of my friends who are teachers, and I said, "How do you guys do this day in and day out?" And the grace that I received from them, it's not like preaching, it's not like teaching a Bible study, it's not like doing the things that I do every day. It's encountering a new subject matter that I'm all too unfamiliar with and all too uncomfortable with. But I realized I wasn't teaching in my kind of style. So I went in with some games. I went in with some flags and some activities and some discussion and some dialogue. And I recalibrated. So I didn't sit in that shame. I looked at what I needed to change. And our faith stories, our faith journeys are not that much different. When you encounter that new experience and you feel those feelings of inadequacy and doubt and struggle, you just need to recalibrate and realize that that journey from inadequacy to worthiness is kind of like that trajectory from shame to grace. Because our growth in faith is marked by realizing that God's call on our lives inherently qualifies us. As students gain confidence through learning and practice, we become more assured of our faith as we experience God's love and provisions. Just as Moses moved from reluctance to embracing his mission, and Peter moved from fear to becoming a foundational figure in the early church, we get to transition from doubting disciples to empowered agents of God's purpose. Our commitment to God's call propels us beyond our initial self-doubt into a life defined by grace and a burning desire to serve. As we step into this new school year, as we step into a new Sunday school year of kids or music or our preschool, anything that we have going on, our scouts beginning to come here, let us embrace these parallels between our everyday life and our journey of faith. Like Moses and Peter, let's recognize that encountering God leads us to a deeper self-awareness. And as we start confessing our inadequacies, our doubt, our limits, let that just be the beginning. Because with time and our understanding of God and ourselves expands, we move from that shame to God's grace. So as we gather in knowledge, whether that be in the classroom, the library, the fellowship hall, the new Gaga ball pit out in the in the Grove. I don't know if you all saw that when you came in. It's a game. We're going to learn. You don't have to play if you don't want to, but we're going to learn. As we gather in these different places of fellowship and learning, and let us just gain that wisdom, gather that wisdom and insight on our spiritual path. Remember, there is a tie between these everyday experiences of the classroom and your own personal faith story, your own personal faith journey. Remember that your worthiness doesn't stem from your achievements or lack thereof, but in fact stems from God's unwavering love. And just as students become scholars, let us evolve into faithful disciples, transforming lives through our commitment to God's call. So may this school year be a journey both intellectually and spiritually for us here at Calvary. As we gather together and we share in this communion table, I remind you that this table is not mine and it's not Calvary's. This is the Lord's table. And therefore, all are welcome to partake of the gift that God has given each one of us. As you come forward, we will do part of the liturgy together. Then you'll be invited forward to receive the communion elements. Return to your seats and wait until we finish the liturgy, where we will take the communion elements together. I invite you to come forward with your hands outstretched as if you were receiving a gift. This just prevents any germs from spreading and cross-contamination of people's fingers. So just come forward like this. And so I invite you to pray with me. Lift up your hearts and give thanks to God. Blessed are you, O God, who with your word and Holy Spirit created all things and called them good. And Jesus Christ, your word became flesh and dwelt among us. And through Jesus' suffering and death, you took upon yourself our sin and death and destroyed their power forever. You raised from the dead this same Jesus who now reigns with you in glory and poured out upon us your Holy Spirit, making us the people of your new covenant. So, Lord, pour out your Holy Spirit on all of us gathered here and on these gifts, that in the breaking of this bread and the sharing of this cup, we may know the presence of the living Christ and be renewed as the body of Christ for the world, redeemed by Christ's blood, until Christ comes in final victory and we feast at your table forever. Amen. I invite my servers to come forward. Can you get Brian? There you are, that one. On the night before meeting with death, Jesus gathered with his disciples where they broke bread. Jesus gave thanks to the Lord, broke the bread, gave it to his disciples, and said, "Take and eat. This is my body, which is given for you. Do this in remembrance of me." When the supper was over, Jesus took the cup, gave thanks to you, gave it to his disciples, and said, "Take and drink. This is the blood of the new covenant, which is poured out for you and for many for the forgiveness of sin. Do this as often as you drink it in remembrance of me." And so, in remembrance of these, your mighty acts in Jesus Christ, we offer ourselves in praise and thanksgiving as a holy and living sacrifice in union with Christ's offering for us. It is through Christ, with Christ, in Christ, in the unity of the Holy Spirit, that all honor and glory is yours, Almighty God, now and forever. Amen. I invite you to stand and join me for a word of blessing and remain standing for our closing hymn. So go in peace, knowing that God loves us so abundantly that he gives us everything we need to move from that shame to the grace and continue in our faith journeys together. Go in peace. Amen.